Hello everyone.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hey, hi. Quite nice to be here, especially with the rain and stuff. So my name is Melvin. This is my first time speaking on a PHP user group meetup. My topic today, I guess, will be streamlining your Laravel code base. Hopefully it's simple for everyone. I only see like a few hands up for Laravel developers. So let's see. Okay, just to introduce a bit of myself, I'm currently working as a web engineer at Tech in Asia. I have two of my colleagues here, Lester and YC, Yuan Chuan. So basically, here are my handles. You can screenshot or get it later. It will appear again later somewhere. So I've actually worked on Laravel applications for like about up to about 3 years already. So my first Laravel application is something that I done actually in school back in NUS. It's actually called NUS Whispers. If you are not sure what NUS Whispers is about, it's basically a confessions page where anonymous people who actually post confessions into their website. And what we do is actually moderate these confessions and post it up to Facebook, to our Facebook page. Right now, NUS Whispers has gotten pretty well, probably like reaching about 18,000 likes already. And it's widely used within the NUS community for lost and found, giving feedback to all the NUS administration and stuff. There's a lot of sagas if you want to see, but yeah, basically. So basically what Laravel has had to do in it is actually, what is powering it is actually the moderation admin, where we at moderators can actually like accept and reject submitted confessions. Then you just automatically submit to Facebook by using the Facebook API. We also offer an API for the front end to consume, which is actually currently on Angular 1.0. It's actually a school project. So right now I'm just maintaining and just keeping Laravel up to date and try out new features and stuff there. After I graduated in NUS at the same year, I actually joined Tech in Asia. And right now, I've been working on the Tech in Asia's Laravel app for quite a while. And what we've been using it is actually to handle the company database where our staff can actually manage startups, companies, investors database where they can add and edit or insert funding rounds and stuff. And we also have recently launched jobs last year. So we use Laravel to actually develop the jobs API where the front end, which is powered by React, consumes it and for applying jobs, finding jobs, sharing profiles with each other, connecting, rejecting, and all sorts of stuff. So if you can say that the Laravel app in Tech in Asia is definitely like 5 or 6 times like bigger than the Whispers app. So let's just talk about Laravel itself. Laravel is a MVC framework, like everyone knows. So this is the basic structure of a MVC framework. For Laravel, because there are so many different variants of MVC, so I'll just call it the Laravel edition. So what you have there is a browser, goes to controller, goes to the model, yep, the usual stuff. But some of the different things is that we have the model talking back to controller. Usually for Laravel case, it may return back to the browser directly because it does not, for Laravel, they will use something called like a blade template, so something like that. They may go through the view as a blade template and display it as a browser. That's assuming you're not using an API solution, based solution. If you are actually developing an API for it, you usually just send out the stuff through your controller without the need of a view as a JSON or whatever, I don't know, XML if people actually use it. So the thing is that when you look at Laravel documentation, you will just see the controllers. They'll just give you a basic idea of a controller. Looks very easy to use. They'll just show you this, like show view controller and display all users with the profile and display it, return it as a view, or rather return it as a JSON if you are using an API. But in reality, the usual workflow of requests in a Laravel usually do more than just that. And then one example is like for handling a post request, you usually do something like you need to validate the post request. You need to check whether the user is actually logged in or whether the user is allowed to actually create a certain thing. Then after you are creating, you actually do the real stuff and create the stuff in the database. Once you're done, usually you want to send notifications to other users, send email. Then you may need to create more relations. Like, let's say you are creating a post, you may need to create categories if needed, if that you want to relate to them. Or you need to log audits, like for data purposes. Like, you want to know who is the one who actually edited the thing or who updated certain sets of stuff in the database. And that's a lot of things. So in reality, when if you put everything together, most of the time, if you ask me, I'm like, if you are new in just knowing that this is just an MV system, everyone will just say, let's just put everything together. Because you just know that, okay, you can't exactly put in a view, you can't exactly put in a view, controller. So most of the time, newer people like myself, like 2 years, 2.5 years ago, will just throw everything into the controller like this. Yeah, I'm not sure, the code is not actually, there's actually more than that. And it is only done, this is just only the validation part, just trying to show that it can be good like this. So eventually there's something like bloated controllers. Controllers that like 1,000, 2,000 lines long all the time. I usually see it like as when you have a, like especially if you are doing in a fast moving company or an app that for a fast moving company. By experience, you'll see that a lot, eventually one and a half years of time, you'll see your core controllers that deal with the core main resource of the, like for example, NUS Whispers is confessions. That confession controller itself will probably be like more than 1,000 lines, 3,000 lines long. So when you think of this, eventually you realize that you actually need more than just a MVC to scale your application efficiently. Now, the problem is that there's two hard things in computer science. One is cache invalidation and naming things. So it's like when you want to refactor something, you need to figure out, how do I name this thing? And most of the time, you'll just figure out how when I'm trying to re-architecture my software application, my Laravel application, what do I actually name all those things? How do I know how to do this? But as it turns out, you realize that how do you want to streamline and refactor your code in such a way that it works nicely and elegantly? You just realize that actually Laravel has actually done a lot of things to like make sure that you are having one step foot right in the door. You don't really need to check like, there's a lot of things for you to help you to go and refactor application to more than just an MVC to be able to scale it. So a few things like events, middleware, observers, policies, gates, broadcasting, queue, email, and notifications. They have been trying to see what you actually most of the developers really need and create a library and layer for you everyone to like utilize it and create an application much more quickly. So I'll just talk about one of the things that more important things is actually more of like events. When I noticed that one of the core things like for NUS Whispers, there's the moderation process of let's say a confession. We always have a state where it says when it goes from pending to approved by an administrator and pending for rejected. So there's a case where when something happens, approved, we actually do something with it. For example, this one we will post to Facebook, and for rejecting, we'll probably delete the confession in Facebook. For a more bigger app like TechNasia, we have our jobs platform. So let's say someone applied for a job, we usually send an email to all the job posting creators. We actually send a notification to the job posting creators as well. And we also create logs as well for the things. And the same thing for connected and skip, we also send notifications via different services like email or notifications at the same time. So when we realize that we can do that, we realize that you can have an event for each of the state. Most of the time, you want to do that in the sense that you can create a confession and a user. So what we'll just do is create an event object, and we'll just inject the confession and the user in as well. So we'll just in the end we'll just refactor the code and just extract out the event itself and emit a new event called confession was approved for sense of like NUS Whispers in this case after approving the confession. So eventually you have, you can split out each of the tasks that you need to do as its own listener. So you have like post confession to Facebook, where you can just inject the dependency inject the third party library that you used. For example, this is Facebook, and just submit one. So you are like abstracting everything out and handling one dependency at a time. So if, then you can just go and create or use the default event service provider and actually write all this down. So eventually, if when you write this down, you probably, everyone can like have, you see like what happens, what did you actually do when you do that event. So confession is approved, I will actually post the confession to Facebook. If I rejected the confession, I will delete the confession from Facebook. Now, the thing is that when you are doing something like this, you are actually killing two birds with one stone. For example, for us at TechNasia, one of the things is that when we tried to send a notification, one the notification service is way over at Japan, and sending one call is like eight to 16 seconds long, can be really long. So if you are doing everything in a single thread, by default, Laravel does everything in a single thread. So you just, users can actually just wait like 8 to 10 seconds just to wait for something like that to happen. So what Laravel actually has is already a ready API to actually queue all this, defer all these listeners to a queued task. So you can actually just set it up, create a message, connect to a messaging service. Right now, there's two providers that we mostly use for AWS, SQS, and Redis. For NUS Whispers, we use Redis, and for TechNasia, we actually use SQS. Both have their pros and cons, but SQS has a certain limit, like it's only restricted by a small packet size, and you only can defer events for like up to 15 minutes. But at the same time, when it comes to cost, probably SQS is cheaper, because you only pay for what you send. Or Redis, you need to maintain and manage the server. So there's pros and cons, depends on what you need to see. So after that, you can actually have your PHP servers set up a supervisor instance, then have it listen to all these jobs that are sent from these providers. In a sense that you can have different instances listen to these jobs. So it's a very scalable solution. If let's say you have like a few thousand over jobs being that need to be processed, and you can split the workload out to different instances when you are in your production environment. So how do you actually convert that into a queued listener? All you need to do is actually just add a thread in the event itself. So what this one does is that it will actually serialize the confession and the user models such that if let's say the user or confession is deleted, you will get it from the database again, and when it finds it's like not found in the database again, it will just terminate gracefully. So in the sense that actually you are preventing race conditions from this. Then you actually add implement should queue on the listeners in a sense that once you will just queue this listener into a queue this as a job and like this. In the sense that you can, for event listeners, if you don't want to use the event pattern, you can actually dispatch this as well using the dispatch function. So if you actually want to go even one layer further for sending notifications for user, Laravel 5.3 actually has a notification system layer API working for it. So you can actually use it to go and further abstract your notifications to send to different messaging parties like Slack or email or notification services, other notification services. There's a lot of like custom notifications channels that are available. And we ourselves actually wrote a few like Mandrill and actually GetStreamIO, which you use it for sending emails and notifications to. So what you just need to do is actually create a notification class where you just create same thing as a job application, and after that, create a function for each of these delivery services. So for to mail, I'll just create a new message. What you're trying to do is actually trying to interface with the custom notification channel to proxy what things you want to send to that, to the notifiable, which is probably the user. So you can actually eventually add this on for more delivery services in the future. Then for what you do, you can just refactor change a bit of your code for your listener and have it to send the notification for like this. So for example, you can actually send this as a queue task as well by using should queue. And after that, send the notifications to all the notifiables. For example, this is actually the function to go and like get all the users to be notified, and then send it as a notification. So testing is actually much easier now, in the sense that you can actually create a controller test case that you only need to care what is the output of the response rather than trying to figure out whether everything else is like you send the notification, whether notification parameters is correct, you're actually doing things like that. All you need to do is you can just mock the events to just expect events to go and say that our expecting a confessions was created event to happen when this API call was made. So you can just put a post API confessions content delivery and check whether the status is like okay, or you can actually set more things like whether the payload is returning a correct ID or anything like stuff like that. Testing listeners is also easier now. You just need to mock the service class that you need when setting up. So for example, this time we just set up the Facebook mock. And when we are handling the case, we can just create like confession. This is like a model factory that Laravel provides. So if you define the model factory, like a model should have this kind of fake data, then you'll create this confession. And then you can actually check whether this thing will receive post from this class and create a listener to handle this. Obviously, this will fail because it should technically receive post. And we also can test notifications now because we can just mock the notifications. We can just fake them, then run the usual case and check whether the notification is actually sent to the user or with the correct notification class. There's also a third argument where you actually can add a closure to check whether all the data that is sent to the notification is actually what you actually expect. So tracing back all the steps, what we do step by step is that first we actually write events for each state, trigger the event at the listener, and write each task as actually event listener, all the small things, one part by part, and attach these listeners to the event service provider. The fifth and sixth step is like quite optional, but you can do it if you need to, if that's like you have a lot of things, like a lot of listeners that take a long time to process and stuff. So fifth is to queue the listeners and notifications at additional level if you have a lot of like notification stuff to send. So here's a little cheat sheet that we do for all the crazy things that Laravel actually provides already. So when you want to filter, modify payload, request payloads, and you want to rate throttle, there's middleware for that. If you want to control who have performed action or something, like you want to know who can actually access, like create a user or delete a user, where do you want to have all this logic to define all this, you can actually create policies for this and use gates to actually control them and return error, like a forbidden error for this. And as shown just now, you can send to Slack or mail or other notifications, you can use their notifications. If you want to validate your request, you can actually inject a custom form request that you do into your controller. If you want to subscribe to events and listen to them like what you do for Socket, you can do, there's also broadcasting. And that's for this one, this is actually a third party service that a library which we use in Attack Ninja is called Factro, where we want to control how the model should like present on its response based on different little based on different policies that we have. So maybe like, if it's an admin, he can see certain things and certain hidden attributes and what's not. So final tip for when working on a new feature, what we do is like, I'll do is basically stare at the Laravel logs for see if anything suitable. Or if not, worst case scenario, research other third-party libraries. There's a Laravel news where they showcase actually Laravel packages, or there's also a curated list in GitHub that ours, like I think has a lot of stars that we can see. Awesome Laravel where it has a lot of data that we can see, a lot of libraries and code bases to go and like study and learn about them and stuff like that. So some of this code available is the real working code. It's actually available at Animus Whispers, GitHub repository. Not all the stuff is new actually. So you'll still see that bloated controller you see over there, still over there. So thank you. That's probably all from me. Any questions?
Questions?
Yeah, for
yeah.
Couple actually.
Yeah.
How do you, just curious with your production experience with Laravel, right?
Yeah.
So how do you track model changes and how do you track app usage? Do you use any third-party libraries?
Model changes within the library itself. Within Laravel itself, right?
Within Laravel,
yes. There's a few ways for doing it. One way to do it is actually something called model observers. Where you actually create a class that handles an event, whether the guy is created, updated, or something like that. But if you want to further abstract a layer of this, you probably want to move, add another layer up there and handle and observe from there instead.
How does that work?
There's something called a L5 repository. So you actually abstract the model into a repository itself, and when you create something, you send an event like the sound event code. On that one, then you go and listen to that event.
Right. So you attach an event that is emitted when any model changes are happening.
Correct.
And
correct.
Then once that happens, usually you deal with it by persisting it a little bit.
Yes, you can do that. So, and you can do that as a custom job. So let's say I want to send another log to audit log. Right. Let's say I change this model to database. I can dispatch it as a event listener and as a queue event, so the user does not need to wait for the load for that. Yeah.
So what about application usage
itself? What are the model changes? Let's say this person has logged in, this person has visited this route.
For this one, we actually track. For this case, it can be done on the application level and actually on the server level. What we've done recently is more on the server level. So we actually check the Nginx logs to see what the user has done. Or if you actually want to have more detail, like application details on like what you want to know, like what user is using this API and everything, you could actually write a terminatable middleware where you can actually just lock down all the things that you want need on the, at the end.
I see. I mean, personally, what I use is
this tracker, this Laravel stats tracker,
yeah.
Available on GitHub.
Mm-hmm.
It's decent, but I was just wondering whether you've got a better solution other than hand coding it.
The problem is that using this application thing is that you are adding the load to your user, so your response time may be slower.
I see.
Yeah.
Any more questions?
Okay, thank you.